Income in renting out property has made real estate a preferred investment for a lot of Filipinos. But there's more to this type of investment than just choosing the right property and looking for a tenant to lease it to. So today, we'll focus on how best to invest in condos for rental income. I'm Edric Mendoza and this is On The Money. Today we have with us property investor Carl D. Welcome to the show, Carl.
Hello, good to be back, Ed.
Yeah, so real estate. Let's ask the first question. What are your tips in general for those who are looking to invest in condos right now?
If you're looking to invest in condos, number one advice would be to make sure you have a steady flow of income. Love your job, work hard so you get a good flow of income. Mm-hmm. And then you can start investing, no? Kasi you have to at least have the down payment. Yeah.
Sure.
Number two, treat your property investment like a business, meaning your unit is your product. So you have to know the features of your product and you always have to give value to your customers. So treat it like a business, meaning you have to understand your target market, you have to market your unit, you have to do a sales pitch, mm-hmm. and definitely don't forget after sales service for your tenant or mm-hmm. your customer. Number three, it's always best that you identify your market. If it's a condo near a school, then your tenant will be your students. If it's a condo near some hospital, maybe your tenant, maybe doctors mm-hmm. or potential patients who are coming in from mm-hmm. overseas. Or if you're in an office, central business district, your tenant will be expats or office workers. Mm-hmm. Another advice would be to design your unit well, to the best that you can afford to. Mm-hmm. Make sure that that it's durable, the quality of finish is there, because I believe that a well-designed unit will stand out in the market and
sure.
make it easier for you to rent it mm-hmm. out. And if the tenant comes in and feel that he has a unique unit, he will stay longer.
Sure.
Another tip is to be prepared to market your unit.
So yourself, no?
Yes.
Market yourself.
Market it yourself or use a broker. But
okay.
Don't stop just after designing your unit. So take nice pictures of your unit, create an enticing description of your unit, highlight the features, and then start to market it out. Mm-hmm. This can be through word of mouth, social media. Mm-hmm. This can be through online classified ads.
Sure.
And lastly, through the professional help of a broker.
Mm-hmm. Oh. How about through the building administrator?
Oh yeah, oo, tama.
No, I mean in that condo.
Right. Yeah. Because the building tenants will know who are your potential
sure.
tenants also.
Sure.
So their friends, office yeah. mates. So it would be nice to tap into
if
them.
They
also.
See that there, no? Parang oh okay.
Yes.
I guess depend also on your market, no?
Right.
Right. Right. Okay. What about competition?
Okay.
Should that be a factor? I mean, knowing what condos are around your condo that you
oh,
want
yeah.
to rent out, diba?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely. Just like any business, mm-hmm. just like a restaurant. If there are two Japanese restaurants together, you're competing for the same market. So
sure.
in condo, just like business, you will have competition. That's why designing your unit is very important. Making sure that your unit has at least one unique feature.
Mm-hmm. At least one.
Yeah,
okay.
This can be like as simple as a big sofa, a bigger LCD than your competitor, extra storage mm-hmm. for female market, extra storage space for shoes, mm-hmm. a makeup area. If it's a market for kids, a nice small room where they can it can be their play area or
That's
study
good.
Area.
Mm-hmm.
So always find something to differentiate your unit.
Okay, let's talk about price.
Okay.
How do you now help determine the rental income or the rental value for your unit?
Oh,
what's the best way to do that?
Do a little research about your market.
Mm-hmm.
How much are they willing to shell out?
Mm-hmm.
And definitely the running rate around the area. So that will give you a general feel of where you're going to price your
right.
unit.
That is comparable to your unit, obviously. No? I
yes.
mean, whatever you'll ask for. Okay. And when you're looking to get a unit prior to even renting it out, no? Can you give tips on pre-selling units versus an already existing unit that
okay.
you can buy and lease out? Your thoughts?
Sige. I always get that question.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a bigger budget on hand already, you can opt to get a ready-to-occupy unit.
Sure.
If that unit satisfies all the requirements and features that you're looking for, then you can get a ready for occupancy unit, RFO. Mm-hmm. If you're going to loan a portion of it to the bank, usually you shell out around 30 to 40% of the costs of the existing unit, because mm-hmm. the bank might appraise it something lower, right, than require 20% equity.
So that will be like your down payment, the 30 to 40.
Yes. Okay. So if you have 30 to 40% ready, and the building is ideal to what you're looking for, sure, then go for the RFO.
Okay.
The advantage of buying pre-selling is the cash out is lower. Mm-hmm. So from 30 to 40%, you can now lower it to almost as low as 10% mm-hmm. for your initial cash out. Mm-hmm. Then the remaining 10%, 15% can be stretched for maybe 3 to 4 years. Mm-hmm. So the pace is generally slower mm-hmm. and easier.
But in terms of the rental income for a pre-selling unit,
yes,
right, that's the downside there, right? You're gonna have to wait till the unit's ready.
Yes.
And then finish all your payments before you can actually, is that right? You have, yes, to finish all your payments before you can actually rent your unit out if it's pre-selling.
Oh, for pre-selling, kasi, there are schemes right now wherein there is a lump sum mm-hmm. on turnover. Mm-hmm. This lump sum can be 60 to 80% of the,
sure,
value. So,
if you pay the lump sum?
If you don't pay for the lump sum, you can, sure, loan it from the bank. So mm-hmm. you can just balance getting rent and paying the bank. Mm-hmm. So the advantage of a ready unit is you get rent. The advantage amount of pre-selling unit is, although you don't get rent yet, you locked in the price. Eh.
I see.
So you kind of earn from inflation.
Right.
Here, the way to compare it is like, imagine two houses. Mm-hmm. One is ready to occupy, selling mm-hmm. for, let's say, 10 million, mm-hmm. and you need 4 million. The other one, ongoing construction, also worth 10 million, but it's not yet there.
Sure.
But the contractor is asking from you only 1 million. So there's a difference between 4 million and 1 million. Mm-hmm. And the contractor tells you, I'm going to build this house over the next 3 years. Mm-hmm. If the prices of steel or cement goes up, I'm not going to pass it on to you. So
it's locked in.
You kind of earn from locking in the prices.
I see. So it really, right, depends on your timing needs,
yes,
and your goals at that time. Very clear. Let's talk about developer.
Okay.
Give me advice. Developer for an RFO or a pre-selling, how does that factor in?
Okay. At least with the ready building, you will already see the finished product. So if you like the finished product and you see that it's being well maintained, so at least the developer concern is not as strong as if it was a pre-selling.
Sure.
So yeah, if you're buying pre-selling, it's very important to look into the developer. Mm-hmm. The way I look at the developer is, he's like your business partner. Mm-hmm. You're gonna give your money to him.
Sure.
So what are his business values? Mm-hmm. Is he financially stable to complete mm-hmm. the project? Mm-hmm. How does he treat his partners? So it's very important that you look into past performance and history.
Sure.
For pre-selling.
Right. Would you say that in general, developers would also vary project to project, or is that not the case for the new types of developments? Because I'm hearing about good, reputable developers, okay, but when you actually get the unit, things are different. Oh. So your thoughts?
I guess there are the big developers who try to maintain a certain reputation.
Sure.
At least you know they do their best to keep on improving. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And there are smaller developers who might be affected by, let's say, out of 5 projects, 1 becomes unsuccessful. Mm-hmm. Maybe the 6th one will be affected.
I see.
It's also dependent on the size of the developer.
Okay, good advice. Now, for an RFO type unit, yep, right, does the developer still play a crucial role, or is it now property managers that you must look into? Who is helping maintain this project now that it's turned over to the condo?
Okay.
Yeah.
Once it's turned over, I think majority of the responsibility is on the homeowners already and the property manager.
Sure.
But there are developers, like from where I work, mm-hmm. that we are also always on the lookout for our buildings, even if we have turned, okay, over to the homeowners.
Sure.
This is because we want to keep the quality of the buildings all across, even if it's old and new. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it depends on.
They still play a role.
Yes.
Okay. Uh-oh. That's good to know. Okay. So let's now go into a Juan de la Cruz that is now going to be renting out their unit. We've seen this macro picture. You have a checklist of things to watch out for?
Okay. Number one, very important, make sure you are dealing with the unit owner.
Okay, that's good advice.
So you don't, yeah, want to give money to, yeah, somebody who doesn't own the unit. Mm-hmm. No? And as you go inside the unit, if you're visually happy with what mm-hmm. you see, maybe just do a little checking on the faucets for leaks, the appliances, mm-hmm. if they're working, mm-hmm. The electricity, if mm-hmm. they're fluctuating or they're consistent, and look closely on the contract to see if there's something that's uncomfortable for mm-hmm. you, something that might need you to buy an insurance sure. or something like that.
Sure. And that's the renter, no? The less.
Yes.
If you're the person renting it out,
okay.
What checklist before you actually now release it to
okay.
the market?
Yeah. If you're the owner of the unit, you have to be careful also not to get a tenant who's number one, who does not pay on time.
Okay.
But that's the easiest part. What you don't want to get are tenants who are into illegal activities.
Sure. So background check.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. Do a little checking. I always advise my friends to at least meet with your tenant, have a chat with them, ask mm-hmm. them some questions. There's actually a trick that you can do with your smartphone.
Sure.
You can do a video walkthrough on your unit. So mm-hmm. it also captures the state of your unit. Mm-hmm. Maybe take a picture together with your tenant. So if your tenant is a bit uncomfortable with what you're doing, you kind of have a feeling that, why?
Why are they afraid to be photographed? I see. That's a good tip.
Yeah.
Okay. What else? I mean, in terms of the look and all that, is it really particular on the tenant or anything that you can do to your unit?
Oh, there's a lot that you can do to your unit. Mm-hmm. Definitely fix it up well. Mm-hmm. Some tricks are to add storage, because mm-hmm. there's a trick.
Look for those competitive advantages
yes.
that you were talking about earlier. Oh. I see. Okay. There are so many other questions that I'd like to throw your way, but we'll save that for the okay. social media portion.
All right.
In the meantime, Carl, we'll just have to pause for a short break. Stay tuned. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On The Money. Let's check what Salve Duplito has for us in Salve Says.
There are over 7 million 20 to 24-year-olds out there. And guess how many of them think about retirement? Well, she does, and she sent us this email. Dear Salve, I am a 21-year-old fresh graduate. I plan on investing as early as now for my retirement in the future. I learned basic investment principles from college. However, I'm torn between investing individually or via mutual funds. What would you suggest, Chi?
Chi, you are my kind of investor, fresh out of college, who thinks long-term. You are at the stage of your life where you're starting to earn for yourself. You're starting to think of living it up. Companies spend billions of pesos to sell perfumes, bags, shoes, clothes, cars to you. And you have the cash. Now you have something that your elders don't have, and that is time. When it comes to being wealthy, time is more important than money itself. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to set up a Life Happens Fund. I don't care if you still live with your parents or you have a place of your own. Set up an account that has 3 months of your monthly expenses. Now, I'm assuming that you don't have credit card debt. You sound like a very smart person. So this means you have a credit card, you use it regularly, but you pay off your balance every month. Now, if you're debt-free and you have up to 3 months of this Life Happens Fund, put the rest of your money in both pooled funds and individual stocks and bonds. Start with mutual funds so you will get the feel of investing. Derive pleasure from your portfolio more than your spending and observe how you deal with the fluctuations of the market. Do you get rattled? Do you have nerves of steel? Learn more about investments every day. And once you get the hang of it, invest some more of your money in individual stocks and bonds. It's better for you to put your money in different baskets. That's because some years stocks are up and bonds are down, and the other way around in other years. The overall goal is to get the best of different worlds. The best teacher in investing is experience. But as you participate in the ups and downs of the bonds and equities market, do not get too caught up in its movements. You still have time to recover if you make mistakes because you're very young. But you will lose money. You pay management fees, you pay broker's fees. Some of the stocks that you buy might not even recover. But that's all part of the learning game. Just keep your eyes focused on retirement and rebalance your portfolio regularly. The next 3 years will be an exciting ride as you keep on learning.
Still with us is property investor Carl D. and of course Melissa Hecule with your money questions. Mel, condos, rentals.
Yes, I know. Great topic. Yeah. Good to see you
again. Hello, Mel.
The first question, I will read this because it's in Filipino. From Vincent, he asks, totoo ba na kapag bumili ka ng condo, kailangan mo ulit bilhin ang unit sa developer after 50 years?
Okay, you will always hear that about a condo being 50 years, then you have to return it back. But no, the 50-year rule is actually after 50 years, the building is now old. It may be not economical to keep on maintaining the building. Mm-hmm. So you now can decide as an association if you wanna tear the building down and reconstruct or just sell the land and just distribute the earnings.
Really? What makes more sense financially? Where will you see more financially?
Okay, versus land or condo. Mm-hmm. Personally, they are two different products. You keep a land for 50 years, yes, it will increase in value, but you get zero rental if it's a residential. If it's a condo, rule of thumb is at around 12 to 15 years, you are already ROI. Anything above that is all, with just with the rental, so you still have your capital. So if the building lives up to 50 years, you have probably made a good return already on your money.
Okay, but if after 50 years you have to decide whether to tear it down, rebuild, or split it up between all the owners and sell it, what's the better option?
I guess it depends on the age group or the energy of the people living in it. So right now you will hear of buildings in Makati that are being resold.
I was going to ask about that. Yeah. So are there are buildings like that that
definitely are undergoing
that?
Yeah. Because let's say you're building, and these are just maybe 30, 35 year old building, but it's old already. The elevator system is not as modern. So everybody just decide and say, okay, we'll just sell the land. And some arrangement will be when the new building comes up, you get a unit. So some will opt to get money.
Or swap.
So it will still be good, especially if you rented out 30 years. You got 30 years of rental.
So I guess as an investor in a condo that's about to hit 50 years, you want to think twice, right? Even if it does have a tenant.
I guess that in.
Yeah.
And when do they decide that? Like 10 years before the 50-year mark? I'm sure they don't decide it. Okay, now it's their 50th year. What do we do?
This will be buildings that were built around 1950s, 1960s. Yeah,
okay. So. But at least we know, to answer the question of Vincent, you don't have to buy it again.
No.
You just decide as a condo.
I guess knowing that information is when you're going to buy a 40-year-old building, then you have to rethink.
So find out the age of your building is what we're learning here. Okay. This is from Grace in Filipino again. May pinapabayaran bang tax sa upa ng condo o lahat ng tax ay sagot ng may-ari?
Okay. The usual practice is for the may-ari to cover for all the taxes.
Sure.
It's so that the tenant will just have a figure in mind that he will shell out, and that's about it.
A fixed rental rate.
So it's a common practice that the owner will pay for the association dues, real property tax, and what else? The VAT on the rent.
Okay. Yeah. Do they, but do you figure in the association dues into the rent?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so that would then
Is that
cover.
Always the case, or are there some who will say, well, you know what, maybe you can cover the...
It's not a common, it's a common practice, but you can go two ways. You can arrange like, oh, you pay for the dues, I guess,
there is no law against...
No law.
There's no law that dictates how the rental is done.
But from a landlord perspective, it's much safer that you hold the money and you make sure you pay for it.
Right.
Then after a few years, you look
back
and say,
your tenant did not pay, right?
Yeah, it's in arrears.
That's a good point.
A problem. Randy asks, from the perspective of the lessee, what should I be on the lookout for when inspecting a condo for rent? Are there parts of the unit that potential renters usually overlook?
Okay, Mel. Number one, make sure you are dealing with the owner of the unit.
Yes.
It's very important.
Yep.
Usually overlooked.
Even when a broker is in place,
you still
want to be with the owner.
So first step is to make sure that you're dealing with the owner. And number two, I guess these are, if visually it's pleasing, so just look into the small details like leaks, water line, is the pressure strong?
Right.
how's the elevator weight? Mm-hmm. How's the amenities? Is it overcrowded or is it maintained to your standards? How are the right. locker rooms? How's the gym? So little things alang. Yeah.
Okay. And I guess how the admin takes care of the building right. and takes care of the tenants.
You yeah. can see the condition. So yeah. okay.
You can also maybe ask around your neighbors or right. how are they doing mm-hmm. in the building.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
A little bit of espionage work.
Yeah.
right?
Yeah, I Mini actually think it's a good yeah. idea to ask the neighbors, what's it like in this yeah. building? How's yeah, the admin?
Just to meet the building admin and say, oh, how's the building? Yeah.
Yeah.
Good
yeah.
advice.
Okay, great, great. Now, Cheryl asks, my parents bought a unit in a condo along Taft. It's a relatively big unit, so they're having a hard time renting it out because the cost is beyond the budget of most students. Mm. What can they do? Income from the unit was supposed to go to their retirement fund.
Okay, Cheryl. If you have a big unit and the budget is over students' rates, change market. Maybe your market is not the students. Mm-hmm. Maybe your market are families who wants to live in that area, who has students mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. or are kids
who are
students
there.
In
right,
that school.
Right.
So
sure.
you change your strategy. And right. I think if you're in an area that is for students, I think your unit being big ones will stand out.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Question, what are your thoughts on subdividing? Opening it up and saying, you know what, your rooms, you can share, four or five people.
Or you split the unit in half yeah. and just make it two units. Can you do that? Is it even
I'm
legal?
I'm not familiar with condominium
right.
deeds
practices.
It's allowed.
So they'd have to check with yeah. the building administration, mm-hmm. I think is what's going to happen, right? If you own the unit, yes. just check with the building administrator because it's yours. Right.
Yeah, you can check if it's allowed to divide it into like three yeah. rooms.
Because I've heard of cases that have done that.
I know that you can connect three units together or two units together, but whether you can
split
break
up one,
mm-hmm. one unit mm-hmm. into two or several mm-hmm. is the question, I guess.
Sure.
Yeah.
Right, I've heard of it being done also. Yeah. I'm not sure if it
So check with the building administrator admin. Guidelines, yeah.
Okay, anyway, I understand that there is a money summit coming up.
Yes, yes.
Could you tell me more about that?
So this July 12 and 13 mm-hmm. at the SMX in Pasay City, there'll be a money summit wherein there'll be around 40 speakers who will be in that venue speaking mm-hmm. about Forex, stocks, real estate, and anything that you want to learn about finances in 2 days. So
okay.
it's a Friday and a Saturday. So you'll be learning about yeah, stocks mm-hmm. and properties, foreclosed properties, and how to take care of your tenants, do's and don'ts, basics, mm-hmm. like
okay.
that.
Okay,
yeah.
excellent.
Yeah.
So I'm sure you'll be there.
Of course, of course.
And we'll try and go there too.
Okay. Thank
yes.
you. Thank
yeah.
you.
Exactly. Anyway, send us your money questions via email, Facebook, or Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
And that's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talking tips so you're always right on the money.